This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. George Herbert Mead on Social Psychology. Selected Papers. Edited and with an introduction by Anselm Strauss. Published by the University of Chicago Press. Introduction. When George Herbert Mead died in 1931 at the age of 68, he had not published a single book. Indeed, he had published few major papers for someone who would gain recognition posthumously as one of the most brilliantly original of American pragmatists. During the decade before his death, sociologists at the University of Chicago, where Mead taught philosophy, discovered what original contributions Mead was making to that branch of their field known as social psychology. Graduate students in sociology flocked to his classes and later were instrumental in introducing his writings on social psychology into the standard sociological literature. His concepts became common property among sociologists, his lines were quoted freely in textbooks, and his pages were reproduced in readers designed for mass student audiences. Through the sociologists, social psychologists who were trained in psychology departments also discovered Mead. While his point of view can hardly be said to be a dominant influence on American sociology and social psychology since World War II, his impact continues to be felt. Moreover, he remains an oft-quoted elder statesman in both fields. Since the 1960s, additional of his writings on philosophy, education, and social reform have been reprinted, and there has been an increased recognition that he is one of America's major thinkers. Only some aspects of his thought, however, have been incorporated into contemporary social science. Part of my purpose in writing this introduction to selected pages of his work is to suggest certain misapprehensions of Mead's intellectual position, as well as to focus attention on its strikingly original character. Unquestionably, Mead can still stimulate new research and theoretical enterprise. American sociology from the 1890s until World War II was dominated by the work of men at the University of Chicago. Although Sumner was at Yale, Ross at Wisconsin, Cooley at Michigan, Giddings at Columbia, and Sorokin later at Minnesota and Harvard, the massed graduate faculty at Chicago, along with its former students, was the major influence upon pre-war sociology. The Chicago Department and its organ, the American Journal of Sociology, were organized approximately when the University of Chicago itself began. That university was, from its outset, to be a graduate institution, for President Harper had deliberately raided competitive scholarly establishments with the express aim of creating the country's most influential graduate departments. Sociology during its earliest years there included at least two outstanding scholars, Albion Small and W.I. Thomas, and in neighboring departments were men like Dewey and Tufts. Within the decade, a star-studded faculty had firmly established Chicago as a dazzling intellectual center. Mead came in 1894 at John Dewey's invitation to the Department of Philosophy, remaining until his death. His influence upon the field of sociology must be attributed, especially in light of his scant writings, to the evolution of sociology at Chicago itself. But the nature of his influence is also linked with his own intellectual career. It is to the latter consideration that I turn first. A striking perspective of Mead's career and influence can be got by comparing him, however briefly, with Dewey. Dewey was born in 1859, Mead in 1863. Dewey published his first book in 1886 when he was 27 years of age, his second in 1888, two more in 1894. And at 43, he was acclaimed for his great volume on experimental logic. His continued regular and voluminous publication on an enormous range of scholarly and public subjects is brought home to us by the posthumous book-length bibliographical itemization of his writing. Mead's output was much more restricted in range, being devoted almost entirely to philosophical and psychological issues, and including a relatively few articles on education, particularly as it related to science and social reform. He was 40 before his first major paper appeared. He had published only two previously on education. whereas Dewey became known to the general public for his educational views during the 90s and the following decade, Mead was listed in Who's Who in America only in 1910, about 7 years after Dewey, because of his full professorship at Chicago. He never came to general notice, except on the local reform scene. He did not become, and probably had no wish to become, the national spokesman for liberal causes that made Dewey such a deservedly conspicuous figure. As for recognition by philosophers themselves, as late as 1912, Ralph Perry, who later edited William James's letters, failed to mention Mead in his present philosophical tendencies, and in James Pratt's Review of Pragmatism, 1909, Mead's early contributions to that movement were also overlooked. Mead finally had his books published for him, as it were, by his students, who either pulled together their collected notes, as in Mind, Self, and Society, or made available his own notes and unpublished writings to the intellectual community. One of the intriguing biographical questions about Mead, then, is his reluctance to publish a major volume, and in a field where books are a staple commodity. Dewey sheds some light on this matter in remarks delivered at his friend's funeral, and later published in Mead's Philosophy of the Present. Dewey's daughter Jane later noted, "The Meads remain the closest friends of the Deweys even after the removal of the Deweys to New York, until their death." Dewey commented that while Mead was an original thinker, he had no sense of being original. Or if he had such a feeling, he kept it under. He also noted Mead's characteristic, great originality, and unusual deference to others. Yet Mead's Philosophy of the Present betrays a rather clear consciousness that he was pushing pragmatism in previously unexplored directions, and a number of passages in his last work, published in The Philosophy of the Act, show him in a critical posture even towards some of Dewey's positions. In his social psychology, developed fully during the 1920s, he certainly must have recognized his own originality. Dewey knew it, and undoubtedly conveyed some of this knowledge to Mead. Again, I quote Dewey's daughter, "Since Mead published so little during his lifetime, his influence on Dewey was the product of conversations carried on over a period of years, and its extent has been underestimated." Indeed, Dewey directly took over Mead's special development of social psychological ideas and made them a part of his subsequent philosophy, so that from the 90s on, the influence of Mead ranked with that of James. We should not be astonished to learn that James was also Mead's teacher, along with Royce. Probably more important than Mead's humility and belated recognition of his own genius was his slight interest in immediate fame, combined with continuous and possibly laborious refining and extending of his ideas. Whatever the explanation for Mead's scant publication during his lifetime, it meant delayed recognition by philosophers. Mead's impact on sociology and social psychology came early. One reason, already alluded to, was that Chicago sociologists carried his ideas from the classroom into their working lives, and as Charles Morris has suggested, into their personal lives also. Mead influenced students like Charles Elwood and L.L. Bernard, but it was not until the 1920s that he had perhaps his major impact on the burgeoning discipline of sociology. Curiously enough, W.I. Thomas and Robert Park, the chief influences in Chicago sociology during the years just before World War I and in the following decade, seem not particularly to have drawn on Mead's thinking, although Park was certainly influenced earlier by Dewey's writing on communication. But the link in the 20s and 30s between the sociologists and Mead was perhaps Ellsworth Ferris, who introduced students directly to the writings of Dewey and Mead. Dewey had come to the sociologists' attention, not only through early writing on communication and education, but through his 1922 lectures on social psychology. Certainly not all of these students read or heard Mead, since there were several streams of faculty influence in the department. An autobiographical note will illustrate that last point. Before I went to Chicago as a graduate student in 1939, I had been directed to the writings of Dewey, Thomas, and Park by Floyd House, who had been a student of Park in the early 20s. House never mentioned Mead, that I can recollect. But within a week after my arrival at Chicago, I was studying Mead's Mind, Self, and Society, directed to it by Herbert Bloomer, who as a young instructor had taught Mead's class after Mead's unexpected death. By 1939, Mead's writing was already getting a fairly wide reading from sociologists, and so he began to enter into the mainstream of sociological thought elsewhere. He began to become the social psychologist for sociologists, as evidenced, for instance, by his later appearance in the standard chapters on social psychology and personality included in sociological textbooks. Why the sociologists found his writing so useful is exactly the question posed some pages ago. A partial answer to that question, perhaps, is that in the thought of leading sociologists, a focus upon psychological aspects of society had long been central. But that answer, I would contend, is only partly satisfying. We must take into account that only certain features of Mead's thought were incorporated into sociology, and we must ask why. Almost exclusively, sociologists lit upon Mead's ideas about socialization, notably his concepts of generalized other and his rather strikingly socialized self. These ideas appealed in the 20s and 30s, because sociologists found them handy ammunition against biological explanations of behavior. Later, they found Mead's notion of self not only an effective counter to Freudianism and to individualistic psychologies, but also a useful way to think about the socialization of group members. By a curious irony of history, Dewey had earlier helped to fill those functions for sociologists. But since in fact he had never worked out Mead's kind of detailed discussion about socialization, his writing today does not appeal much to sociologists. In general, I would argue that what sociologists, including such widely read functionalist theorists as Parsons, Davis, and Merton, selected from Mead's writing was very restricted, and pertained mainly to how culture and norms got internalized into the person, that is, how self-control was a reflection of social control. Mead's treatment of the self as a process was transformed into something much more static, in accordance with the sociological view of internalized social control. The generalized other became just another way of talking about reference group affiliation, and Mead's notion of role tended to be reinterpreted to fit with the structural concept of status and its associated role-playing. It is even possible to maintain that sociologists, who tend principally to be social determinists, read Mead as if he too were a social determinist, although his reiteration of the potential influence of individuals upon society should have warned against any such interpretation. Whether the main drift of Mead's thought was reinterpreted is perhaps debatable, but the selective attention given it is not. Quotations from Mead are almost always taken from the self section of Mind, Self, and Society, Mind and Society getting short shrift. Mead's remarkable treatment of time, hardly touched upon in that volume, but treated extensively in Philosophy of the Present and in the Philosophy of the Act, has not yet been mined for its relevance to sociological concerns. His concept of perspectives, again worked out in much detail in those volumes, has not penetrated sociological thinking much, nor has its implication for social change been understood. His strikingly processual view of social organization has yet to receive that elaboration which would freshen and perhaps transform more traditional views. His philosophic handling of the relations between permanence and change, that is, the problem of continuity, surely will eventually have its proper impact on sociological thought. What can be said about Mead's use by and impact on social psychologists and sociologists in the period since 1965? To begin with, the ritualistic quoting of or mere referring to Mead continues steadily, in textbooks and in serious writing alike. By ritualistic, I mean that it is not especially clear that Mead has affected the basic stance or work of the author. There is also an occasional germane effort to relate one's research to specific ideas or suggestions by Mead. However, the constant and probably increasing influence of Mead is linked with the complicated intellectual history of the 1960s. Telescoping that history severely, one can say that functionalism lost much of its attractiveness for younger American sociologists. Its competitors have included phenomenology, ethnomethodology, neo-Marxism, and the continuing tradition of interactionism. None of those constitutes a homogeneous school, regardless of outsiders' perceptions, but all have paid some attention to Mead, whether approvingly or disapprovingly, whether agreeing with elements of Mead's thought or qualifying it. Thus Chikoral, an ethnomethodologist, To the Meadian dialectic of the I and the me is added the notion that participants in social exchanges must assume that their use of verbal and nonverbal signs or symbols are the same, or this sameness, in an ideal sense, must at least be assumed to hold. More generally, Chikoril believes that a scholar like Schutz has made more explicit the ingredients of social interaction also discussed by James Mead. Similarly, a collection of essays entitled Phenomenological Sociology contains enough references to Mead to make one suspect that he is at least part of the intellectual apparatus of those who think of themselves as phenomenologists, albeit alternative intellectual idols yield them more stimulation or inspiration. On the other hand, to most neo-Marxists, Mead doubtless seems irrelevant or misleading, since he, like Dewey, represents a classic specimen of American liberalism. Muddle-headed meliorist, idealistic, stargazer at his best and misguided, if perhaps implicit, supporter of capitalism at his worst. A frontal attack by a young sociologist on the entire interactionist tradition, including Mead, finds it structureless, focusing on microscopic interaction and virtually ignoring the larger social structures which determine interaction. Yet particular younger sociologists seem ready to attempt a reconciliation of Marx and Mead. To some, the Marx represented by the long unavailable Grundriss seems to hold views not entirely at sword's point with the pragmatists who followed some years later, all unaware of this aspect of Marx. See, for example, Rogers' attempt at reconciliation of neo-Marxism and Mead, albeit he seems more bent on reconciliation with Mead. Mead, however, has always had his most extensive audience in sociology among the interactionists. Among the younger sociologists, the social and political events of the late 1960s led to a resurgence of interest in interactionism, for it represents a more voluntaristic view of social life than social structuralism and a more direct contact with people in the field than questionnaire research. The older interactionists, Bloomer, Lindesmith, Becker, Clapp, Stone, Shibutani, continue to draw for general stance or specific ideas upon Mead. The younger interactionists, influenced of course by their teachers, who at the very least introduced them to Mead, also draw visibly from Mead's writings. Perhaps some of the seemingly ritualistic offerings to Mead really represent a non-specific, but very genuine debt to the man. Also, with the diffusion of interactionist thought and of phenomenological sociology across the Atlantic, Mead has come to the attention of Europeans. A friend of mine at the Center de Sociologie Européen volunteered that Mead was a remarkable man, albeit another able French scholar, equally influenced by interactionism, does not once mention Mead in his book on American sociology. In Germany, where phenomenology is relatively strong and sometimes combined with interactionism, partly via the influence of Berger's and Luckmann's construction of social reality and by their actual teaching in Germany, Mead is increasingly noted and quoted. By contrast, the English have discovered Mead largely through the footnotes of American interactionists. In general, among Europeans, the influence of Mead seems also to have generated a general stance toward issues of identity and interaction. General, because it is difficult to assess accurately how Mead does speak to his overseas readers, who after all do operate in somewhat different intellectual climates than our own. The richness of Mead's writing for sociological enterprise can only be suggested in this brief introduction. Perhaps a few examples will suffice. Let us take the matter of time, in which there has been some renewed sociological interest. In general, much of the sociological writing on organizations leaves their temporal features unanalyzed. When handled explicitly, the focus is upon such matters as deadlines, scheduling rates, pacing turnover, and concepts of time, which may vary differentially by organizational position. The principal weakness of such analyses stems from an unexamined assumption that the temporal properties worth studying pertain to the work of organizations and their members. For instance, the work time of personnel must be properly articulated, hence deadlines and schedules. Breakdowns in this temporal articulation occur not only through accident and poor planning, but through differential valuation of time by various echelons, personnel, and clientele. But a close reading of Mead suggests that the temporal order of the organization be analyzed in terms of a much wider range of temporal dimensions, for, as stated by Mead, perspectives imply temporality. One way of translating Mead's conception is to take seriously the idea that people bring to any organization their own temporal concerns, and that their actions on the organizational site are profoundly affected by these concerns. Thus, in a hospital, one should study not only the organization of work time, schedules, deadlines, timing of work shifts, but many other considerations deriving from more subtle temporal concerns. For instance, we might scrutinize the previous hospital experiences of patients and personnel, their hospital careers, their experiences with various types of illness, their illness careers, their personal careers, and the highly personalized conceptions of time evidenced, for instance, by dying patients. The family's temporal concerns are also of great relevance. This discussion leads me to remark upon Mead's rather implicit treatment of social organization and society. He sometimes referred to these matters in rather structured terms, but most often a processual view dominated his writing. He pictured social structures as somewhat less organized than do most sociologists and anthropologists. The implication is that organizations are something like Melville Dalton's description of industrial establishments. They somehow work, although they have no single goal, no wholly agreed upon consensus, but they service the diverse aims of their personnel and clientele through bargaining, deals, agreements, and negotiation, plus the more institutionalized mechanisms. Something like a concept of negotiated order seems implied by Mead's views. When one sees this, it is a simple matter to link it with the preceding discussion of temporality. For the various temporal considerations brought to groups and organizations must receive some articulation, although precise details must be empirically discovered through research. In general, however, there are organizational mechanisms which contribute toward that temporal articulation, but there are also non-institutional mechanisms, including continual negotiation and certain less self-conscious forming of agreements. Temporal order refers to this total, delicate, and continuously changing articulation of temporal considerations. Such a conception of temporal order fits very well with Mead's continual emphasis upon emergence in social relations. He and Dewey are, in fact, our great American spokesmen among the philosophers of what was once referred to as emergent evolution. For contemporary sociology and social psychology, this concept might mean that persons are somewhat freer agents than is allowed in the more usual sociological view. Freer not only to find ways to circumvent norms and rules, but also freer to help change the social structures within which they find themselves. More than one critic of social or cultural determinism has argued against the model of the individual as mere reflection of the larger social unit, or even as something of an automaton. But that critique need not necessitate an abandonment of the tremendously useful mode of thinking which we call structural. That analytic mode need only be combined with a systematic search for the particular groups of individuals which are able to institute given changes, or to evade what specific rules and why, and under what conditions, and with what consequences to the establishment, to themselves, and to others. The supplementary inquiry, of course, is who obeys or attempts to make other people obey those rules, and why, how, and with what consequences. Among social scientists in the contemporary period, there is a strong reaction against reification of social structures and against reliance on extreme structural explanations, with a revised view of social organization and organizations as more open and fluid. Mead's influence on these intellectual trends, however, seems to have been either incidental or transmitted through the writings of sociologists like E.C. Hughes and Herbert Bloomer and their students. I myself believe that Mead's processual perspective on the constructed and continually reconstructed world, plus his suggestive analysis of the nature of symbolic transactions, imply a pathway through which we might escape some of the more limiting conceptualizations to which many social scientists adhere. For instance, he directs us, albeit implicitly, to look at modern society as if it were a congeries of social worlds. Alternative models of mass society conceptualize it as composed of anonymous, alienated individuals, as highly bureaucratized and/or rationalized, and so forth. The Meadian vision of society does not necessarily preclude those others, but we can hold them in abeyance while looking at society qua social worlds. In one of his seminal passages, Mead asserts that in the most highly developed, organized, and complicated human social communities, individuals have membership in two kinds of groups. Some are concrete social classes or subgroups, like political parties, clubs, and corporations. Then Mead points to what are generally termed aggregates, but which he refers to as abstract social classes or subgroups, such as the class of debtors and the class of creditors. Mead characteristically conceives of this second type of group in interactional and processual terms. He hazards that in individuals, membership in several of these abstract social classes or subgroups makes possible his entrance into definite social relations, however indirect, with an almost infinite number of other individuals who also belong to or are included within one or another of these abstract social classes or subgroups, cutting across functional lines of demarcation which divide different human social communities from one another, and including members from several, in some cases from all, such communications. Then he relates this membership to significant symbols and universes of discourse, in short, to the social process of communication. This amounts not merely to a recognition that any aggregate has the potential of becoming a functioning group. Lewis Worth used to say that potentially groups can form around anything, antipathy toward Jews, white skin, but that the basic social process of communication permits an enormous, unlimited, and ceaseless proliferation of functioning groups. These can be severely delimited social worlds, such as Harvey Zorba, described for Chicago in the 1920s, or as in recent years have been studied for the same city by Morris Janowitz and his students, Gerald Suttles and William Kornblum, or international in scope, the worlds of physicists, chess players, or advocates of birth control. They can be rooted in or transcend space. They can be tiny or enormous in membership. They can have relatively discernible, tight boundaries or permeable, fluid boundaries. The activities and the communications of members can focus primarily on matters intellectual, occupational, professional, political, religious, sexual, or recreational. Social worlds are characteristic of any substantive area. Furthermore, some organizations can be viewed as embedded within a social world. The American Medical Association in the world of medicine, the Daughters of Bilitis in the homosexual world, so that they cannot be understood merely by focusing only on them, but require an examination of their relations to other organizations embedded either in the same or in related worlds. Some, possibly most, organizations can also be viewed as arenas wherein members from various subworlds or other worlds stake differential claims, seek differential ends, engage in contests, and make necessary alliances in order to do the things they wish to do. The Meadian emergent evolution via communication view also implies that social worlds inevitably splinter or fragment, but that conversely the members of different subworlds are always joining forces, so that there is alliancing, merging, coalescing, which processes may lead subworlds to dissolve, disappear, or at least pull out from the original world. The Meadian view also implies that social movements are not merely features of political or religious arenas. Most literature on social movements is restricted to those arenas, but of all social worlds and subworlds. There are movements in painting, poetry, literary criticism, and certainly in the academic disciplines and subspecialties. Some of these movements spill over to more than one other world. Generally, they result in organizations or affect extant ones. Other phenomena can be usefully reconceptualized in terms of social worlds. Thus, fashion is not limited to clothing styles. Fashions flourish in every world. Also, careers are not in character simply organizational or occupational. They are pursued within and can only be understood fully by taking into account the context of specified social worlds. Moreover, notions of the mass media ought to be corrected. There are multiple media magazines in many worlds, most of which never reach the newsstands or come to the attention of social scientists. Also, public opinion is not simply a matter of legislation and government, but arises in every social world and segments of it, around issues perceived of importance by its members. Also, nations probably should not be conceived as organized around a common value system, or as consisting of a core and a periphery, with people on the periphery, workers in 19th century France, as essentially out of society. A nation is perhaps better conceived as a territory within which various social worlds exist, local, regional, national, also international, with a variety of relationships among them. Likewise, the members of certain worlds have much more control over the governmental apparatus, including the power to manipulate and coerce the members of other social worlds, not excluding those who, like the members of some religious sects, do not really conceive of themselves merely as members of the nation, or others, members of nationality groups, who may only be part of the nation by virtue of force or coercive negotiation. Mead might not have accepted such deductions from his work, so I shall have to accept sole responsibility for asserting them. However, another admirer of Mead unquestionably has drawn some of the same conclusions. For some years ago, Tomatsu Shibutani astutely formulated his version of a central issue of Mead. Each social world is a universe of regularized mutual response, an arena in which there is some kind of organization that facilitates anticipating the behavior of others. Each social world, then, is a culture area, the boundaries of which are set neither by territory nor formal membership, but by the limits of effective communication. The limits of effective communication. That suggests both the difficulty and the challenge of following through on Mead's message, or at least on some of his message. The major dimensions of Mead's thinking are perhaps best grasped in relation to several intellectual antecedents, for these flit in and out of his pages in the guise of protagonists or allies. From his predecessors, Mead took his basic problems, some of his terms, and parts of his suggested solutions. By the outset of the 19th century, natural science had had a shattering effect upon earlier conceptions of the universe and man. Scientists now worked with notions of a world of matter in motion. This could not but have an effect upon philosophic and political thought. Individualistic doctrines developed which regarded the individual knower as a passive receiver of the physical world impinging upon his sense organs. Individual freedom, individual autonomy, the doctrine of natural rights, contract, the rule of reason, atomistic theories of group life, all these reflected the impact of 17th and 18th century science. These brands of individualistic and rationalistic philosophy were countered early in the century by idealistic philosophers, notably by the influential German Romantics. Intuition and faith displace reason as the cornerstone of knowledge and action. The passive individual in an impinging physical world is supplanted by a world which has existence only in relation to an active agent. Group, folk, spirit, and collectivity take precedence over the autonomous individual, and the later Darwinian revolution is ushered in with mystical and historical conceptions of change, evolution, and development. Other pre-Darwinian philosophers, like the Frenchman Auguste Comte, exalt the role of reason in the form of science but, like the Romantics, conceive of individual action within societal contexts. The Romantic writers had a profound influence upon Mead, as upon Dewey, insofar as they stressed social evolution and made the environment in some subtle sense dependent upon the acting organism. But since Mead lived after Darwin, the Romantic treatment becomes in Mead's hands divested of its mysticism and is given biological and scientific twists. Most important, the role of reason again is raised in high service to human action, where rationalists and political liberals had placed it, rather than made subordinate to faith and intuition. Likewise, the Comtean rejection of metaphysical thought and adulation of scientific method are taken over almost wholly, but the specific interpretation of the method, along with that of Comte's rationalistic contemporary, J.S. Mill, is rejected in favor of an evolutionary and highly social interpretation. Mead also, in ways reminiscent of the French sociologist Durkheim, finds in Comte ammunition against individualistic psychological theories. But it is to Darwin and his successors that Mead is most indebted. He regarded Darwin as having provided the empirical underpinning for the revolutionary but inadequate romantic notions of evolution. The corpus of biological writing allows the pragmatist to challenge mechanical conceptions of action and the world, and to restate problems of autonomy, freedom, and innovation in evolutionary and social rather than mechanistic and individualistic terms. Mead's pragmatic devotion to reason prevents him from going the way of certain descendants of Darwin, Freud, MacDougall, Veblen, and Lebon, among others, who stressed irrational and non-rational determinants of human behavior. Darwin's work itself, insofar as it deals with man's psychology, is given an elaborate recasting by Mead. Darwin's treatment of expressive gestures is revised in the light of human communication, and biological evolution emerges in the topmost species as something new and different, a true emergent. Among Mead's important predecessors were those psychologists who pursued genetic interests. The study of child development, itself receiving great impetus from evolutionary writing, became focused upon the rise of speech, thought, and self, in contrast to a later concern with emotional and personality development. Mead owes some of the focus of his work to Tarde, and to his contemporaries, Baldwin and Cooley. Later he took issue with the Watsonian brand of behaviorism. It excluded covert aspects of human acts as metaphysical or mental, whereas Mead wished to include mental activities within the orbit of the social act itself. To indicate the extent of his agreement and divergence, he titled his own approach Social Behaviorism. The outlines of Mead's philosophical system are sketched in those selections comprising Part 1 of this volume. In Evolution Becomes a General Idea and the Problem of Society, Mead, the philosopher of evolution, is asserting the primacy of the evolutionary process. This process flows not only through species but through societal organizations, the human included. As species disappear and evolve, so do institutions and societies. In man, evolution can be directed through intelligent action, itself made possible by the purely human capacity for symbolization. Science is the finest instance of intelligence at work and represents the hope of mankind for the solution of problematic social situations. Because of human intelligence, with its associated self-reflexiveness, social institutions can indefinitely take new forms. Like Dewey, Mead is saying that the Darwinian revolution has forever unfettered us from static conceptions of social organization. This initial line of reasoning introduces us, in large scope, to three of Mead's central preoccupations. 1. Science as the instrument, par excellence, for the intelligent control of environment, physical and social. 2. The rise and function of socially reflexive behavior. And 3. The problem of maintaining order in a continuously changing social organization, that is, the problem of intelligent social control. Mead's social psychology is dominated by the second preoccupation, his social philosophy by the third, while his more technical philosophical concerns are focused around the method of science and particularly its implications for control over and contact with the environment. When Mead writes about scientific method, he does so in accordance with the basic pragmatic position on intelligence. Intelligence is really a verb, not a noun. It is an activity which arises whenever an organism encounters ambiguity in its world. But what is ambiguous or problematic is always in relation to what is known or taken for granted. This is true for all organisms, including the scientist himself. In the essay entitled The Nature of Scientific Knowledge, Mead is particularly interested in relating the scientist's act to the larger communal context. It is the particular scientist who recognizes and is disturbed enough by ambiguity to wish to fashion an appropriate scientific solution. What appears ambiguous to him does so because he is a member of a particular society at a given time and place. While the problem arises within the individual thinker's experience, he must eventually bring his solution to the community for validation. In doing so, he makes a contribution, however minute, toward changing his community. He contributes toward change, not merely because he has answered a vital question, but because his answer may challenge some portion of that which was taken for granted in order to raise and answer the question in the first place. Mead has here affirmed that the scientist, indeed any human, affects his social world just because he is a sentient, acting being. Scientific method is merely the most effective way to incorporate continuously arising problematic experiences into an ongoing social order. Mead is interested in the relationship of the scientist to the physical world as well as to the social. He contends that the scientist is interested not in trying to grasp the structure of the world, but in going after the solution of a problem in a world which is there. Like the German Romantics, Mead makes the environment relational to the person, but he anchors the relationship firmly within community action. Through the thinker's problem-solving act, the world gets revised and enlarged. Intelligent activity does not seek to know the world, but undertakes to tell us what we may expect to happen when we act in such and such a fashion. In the selection titled Mind Approach Through Behavior, Mead suggests how the pragmatists, especially James and Dewey, met the challenge of the newer currents of science by discarding a structural psychology and moving toward a behavioristic science. The pragmatists, Mead included, emphasize the active role that men play in shaping their environments and destinies, a recurrent theme in Mead's writing. In The Process of Mind in Nature, a general philosophical treatment with social psychological implications is given to relationships existing between the subject and the physical world. Romantic philosophy had failed because it denied the presence of a physical world that lay outside and preceded the organism. However, Mead retains the romantic idea that the organism is an active agent rather than a passive recipient of external stimuli. His central thesis is that action, the act, determines the relation between the individual and the environment. Stimuli are encountered during the act and affect its course, and their function is misconstrued if we state otherwise their relation to the active organism. Identical stimuli are different for different organisms and for the same organism during different acts. Perception is selective and occurs during action. In addition, Mead makes action toward the self an integral facet of the act. One takes himself into account while acting toward the non-self. This self-reflexivity is dependent upon language and arises during childhood as a result of participation in groups. Mead is thus making of human perception an exceedingly complicated activity, in which stimuli are responded to selectively during the course of acts and are interpreted symbolically and with reference to self. Since acts may have considerable duration and perception functions in the act and all along the act, the perceived environment is different by the end of the act from that at the beginning. Some objects of perception have been redefined, others have dropped out as functionally unimportant, and new ones have arisen. These new objects and redefinitions are funneled back to the groups and communities to which the individual belongs, for the individual's act, and is incorporated perceiving, is itself but a segment of the larger communal action. In the selections taken from mind, self, and society, we see Mead's elaboration of the basic positions already sketched. Nothing new is added except detail, but to the social psychologist, this detail is essential. Here Mead offers us a set of concepts directly pertaining to crucial matters such as complex mental activities, self, self-control, audience, role-playing, social interaction, motivation, group membership, and group functioning. We left Mead relating perception to act. He develops this relationship further. Stimuli arise during the act and affect its course. The stimuli may arise in the form of the actions of others, whose action in turn may be a response to ours. In all species except man, where the process is more complex, the gestures of each animal set off immediate answering gestures, barks, growls, movements in the other. The entire course of the interaction Mead terms the conversation of gestures. This conversation can be cooperative, as among a hive of bees, or antagonistic, as in a dogfight. No self-consciousness need be attributed to the responding animals. Among humans, the conversation is much more complex, for we typically indicate to ourselves the meanings of our own gestures. This assigned meaning is in terms of the perspective of some other person, often the person toward whom we are directly acting. But others who are absent may be implicated in our gestures, we may be acting toward them too, and in answer to their gestures. When our gestural meanings take on identical meanings to ourselves and to others, we have the significant gesture or significant symbol. Mead hypothesizes that only through the verbal gesture, sounds, could man have become self-conscious about his gestures, but this seems not to be a necessary point in his argument. The important point is that typically human meaning arises during cooperative group action. In simpler terms, we may say that every group develops its own system of significant symbols which are held in common by its members and around which group activities are organized. Insofar as the members act toward and with reference to each other, They take each other's perspectives toward their own actions, and thus interpret and assess that activity in communal terms. Group membership is thus a symbolic, not a physical matter, and the symbols which arise during the life of the group are in turn internalized by the members and affect their individual acts. The symbolic conversation of gestures need not take place between actual persons, but may occur inside a single person. Here we have thought or mental activity. The person imaginatively acts and, with the positions of significant other individuals in mind, looks back at his proposed action. Mead underlines the fact that this internalized conversation allows men to bring the future into the act, as opposed to language-less animals, who must respond rather immediately and directly to present stimuli. Human thought involves the pointing out of meanings to oneself and thus requires a self-conscious actor, one who can delay overt action while he surveys the meanings and consequences of proposed acts in terms of others' probable responses. In the end, the person can put a number of responses together in unique combination, a very complex act indeed. This is Mead's elaboration of the much simpler notion of the act with duration, discussed in earlier selections. The organization of responses requires an actor who also acts toward himself. One must be simultaneously his own subject and object. Mead asks how this is possible, and he again answers by looking at the communicative process. What is necessary to become an object to self is that the individual step outside himself, so to speak, and look back at himself. Mead, following numerous genetic psychologists, notes that the infant cannot do this. He suggests some general steps in learning to take others' roles towards self. The most important is when the child learns not only to assume multiple positions via a vis himself, but to organize these positions into a system. Childhood games, Mead suggests, are among the situations in which the child acquires the ability to do this. This generalized system of attitudes is termed the generalized other, Mead's best-known term. The generalized other is society's representative in the individual. In the absence of others, the individual can yet organize his behavior with regard to his conception of their related attitudes. Hence, the generalized other is closely linked in Mead's discussion, both with self-control and with social control. Mead says this in yet another way, by setting the me against the I as two responding sides of the self. The me is the controlling, limiting, societal side of the person. The I is the impulsive side of behavior, upon which the me makes a judgment after the person acts, immediately after, or long after, or many times after. The I is never completely predictable, one may surprise oneself. Hence it is the I which introduces novelty and creativeness into the situation. Action which surprises self can be exciting as well as disturbing. Like the scientist's new solution, it can change what formerly was taken for granted. Consistently, Mead asserts that this novel behavior and its assessment occurs within large social contexts and reacts back upon those contexts. Everyone makes some contribution toward changing his community. This socialized individualism is pursued further by Mead. Insofar as each individual participates in different groups or participates in identical groups in different ways, it follows that no man's me's are identical with any other man's. This gives ample leeway for an emphasis upon individuality within worlds of common symbolization. In the sections dealing more specifically with society, the relationships between individual and ideal communality are further discussed. In Part 8, some of Mead's views of Comte, Cooley, and Bergson can be read. We find him noting with approval, for instance, Comte's conviction that we must advance from the study of society to the individual, rather than from the individual to society. But Mead also criticizes the earlier positivistic conceptions of scientific method held by Comte and his contemporary Mills because of their misunderstanding of perception and the possibilities of novelty raised by perception. Mead appreciates the work of his own contemporary, Cooley, on the nature of the self, but believes that Cooley never quite freed himself from a dependence upon biological explanation. His conception of self was not sufficiently social. Bergson's emphasis upon novelty and the exciting possibilities of life are lauded by Mead, but his own emphasis upon science and rationality leads him to point a critical finger at Bergson's reliance upon irrationality. In History and the Experimental Method, Mead suggests that the past, historical or otherwise, is significant not in itself, but in relation to present and future action. There is no single past to be recaptured in its pure essence, only a past reconstructed from within a current frame of reference. There are thus as many pasts as there are perspectives. This statement of the noble office of the historian is another version of the hypothesis that remembering is an active process, reconstructive and highly selective. Other psychologists have investigated memory from this same viewpoint. What Mead adds is that remembering is always part of larger acts. From this follows his discussion of social movements and their reconstruction, even construction of their own pasts. Finally, in the excerpts on Time from Philosophy of the Present, we see Mead thinking with great originality and expressing himself with unusual felicity and brilliance. With characteristic emphasis upon emergence, he argues that reality is always in the present, that the past refers to that conditioning phase of the passing present which enables us to determine conduct with reference to the future which is also arising in the present, and that the novelty of every future demands a novel past. Mead links particular presence with particular social acts in which one is engaged, so that what he terms functional presence rather than specious presence are the important phenomena, linked as they are with the social enterprises in which individuals are engaged. Mead's most brilliant elaboration of temporality as genuine possibility is found, perhaps, in the selection titled The Objective Reality of Perspectives. Here he reviews and criticizes Whitehead's notion of an organization of perspectives, carrying Whitehead's one step further by relating that organization to social organization itself via conceptions already encountered by the reader in excerpts from Mind, Self, and Society. Mead's elaboration of his ideas about temporality was abruptly ended by his unexpected death. Since those ideas are among his best, they ought to be more widely known. The mounting interest in Mead's writing today, combined with his complexity as a thinker, has brought about different interpretations of what he really meant. Debates about various of his views have been carried on in the sociology journals, and recently two philosophers have differed about whether Mead retained essentially the same position over the years, or whether his philosophy of the present represents his most mature perspective. Another philosopher speaks of Mead's work as a major unfinished system of thought, but Berenice Fisher, a sociologist historian, agrees with an earlier judgment of Charles Morris that Mead was not a systematic thinker, but used his lectures to work out a series of constantly developing ideas. This indeed seems to be one whole aspect of Mead's thinking, his lecture style of moving into a problem at various angles, his addresses to different audiences, groping with different aspects of the social world, his discussions about the problems of time and perspective. We can certainly expect this continuing reinterpretation of Mead's thought to continue, but as Fisher perceptively remarks, without the still unwritten biography of Mead, these various images of him as a man of knowledge, his role as teacher and colleague, his involvement with social reform, his working out philosophic problems, his fate in the hands of his successors, must have a certain ambiguity. And in the mid-30s, Morris wondered whether Mead's democratic idealism could survive the growing political forces on the right and the left. Morris seemed to feel that Mead's contribution to social psychology could endure separate from this broader social commitment. But that is doubtful. Rather, the reconstruction of his thought would have to include both, and the survival of the basic insight would be contingent upon the kind of man who could understand it. In short, Mead seems due for increasing reconstruction, rediscovery, reassessment, rephasing, redeciphering, and no doubt continuing retranslation. Since his thought is so rich, the reworking will doubtless reflect his complexity. Part 1. Chapter 1. Evolution becomes a general idea. Passing as we have from Kant to the Romantic idealists, we proceed from a conception of static forms which are originally given, and which serve as the whole basis of Kant's transcendental philosophy, to an idea of the development of the forms through a process, an evolutionary process. Kant conceived of the basic forms of the world as being given in the character of the mind itself. the forms of space and time, given in the sensibility, the forms of the understanding, given in the categories, and the forms of the reason, are all there in advance of experience. If the object, as such, arises under Kant's doctrine, it is because of certain contents of the sensibility passing into these forms. That is what makes it an object. It is not an object for our cognitive experience unless it has these forms that give it its reality. Sensuous experience itself, unless it takes on some form, has no meaning, no reality. It cannot be known except insofar as the experiences have some form. And in the Kantian doctrine, the form is given in advance. This is what Kant expressed in terms of the transcendental logic, the term transcendental, meaning the logical pre-existence of the form to the object. This concept, you see, belongs to pre-evolutionary days. The logical pre-existence of the form to the object cannot be stated in terms of process, therefore it falls outside of evolutionary ideas. In order that there might be an object there, Kant, as over against the empiricists, said that the form must be there originally in advance. The latter undertook to show how an object might arise out of the mere association of different states of consciousness. Kant insisted that in order for there to be an object, the form must be there first. But the romantic idealists changed all that. For them, the forms arose in the very process of experience, in the process of overcoming antinomies, overcoming obstacles. We are responsible for the forms. In other words, we have in experience, not a pouring of the characters of our sensibility, colors, sounds, tastes, odors, into certain fixed forms, but a process of experience in which these very forms arise. Logic, as the Romanticists conceived of it, was a dynamic, not a static affair, not a simple mapping out of judgments which we can make because of the forms which the mind possesses, but a process in which these very forms themselves arise. The process of experience, according to these idealists, creates its own forms. Now this has a very abstruse sound, of course, but what I want to call your attention to is that it is nothing but an abstract statement of the principle of evolution. These romantic idealists were undertaking in the field of philosophical speculation what Darwin and Lamarck were undertaking in the field of organic phenomena at the same period. What the romantic idealists and Hegel in particular were saying was that the world evolves, that reality itself is in a process of evolution. This was a different point of view from that which characterized the Renaissance science of which I have previously spoken. This Renaissance science started off with just as simple elements as it could. It started with mass and motion. And Newton defined mass first as a quantity of matter, but as that involved a conception of density and there was no way of telling just how dense your matter was, he had to get another definition. And he found it in terms of inertia, that is, the response which a body offers to a change of state in either its rest or its motion. If you want to measure the mass of a body, you measure its inertia. You see how much force is necessary to set it going, and so forth. And in that way you measure its mass, so that mass is really measured in terms of accelerations, that is, accelerations that you add to motions of a body. We come back to these simple conceptions of mass and motion, but we really define our mass in terms of certain sorts of motion, that is, velocities and accelerations. With these very simple conceptions, the physicist undertook to build up a theory of the world. Newton gave the simple laws of mass and motion, and then, on the basis of mathematics, worked out an entire mechanics, which up to within a very short time has been the classical theory of the physical world. On the basis of this physical theory, there is just so much motion, there is just so much mass, there is just so much energy in the universe. When the system was more fully worked out, as it was in the 19th century, the principles of the conservation of energy were added to those of Newton, although they were implied in his system anyway. Now such a world as this is made up simply of physical particles in ceaseless motion. That is all there is to it. We speak of the different objects about us, trees, houses, rivers, mountains, all varied, all part of the infinite variety of nature, but what this science does is to break them up into ultimate physical particles, molecules, atoms, electrons, and protons. The object is nothing but a congeries of these, and as already stated, the relationship between the particles in one object and in another object are just as real and just as important as the relations found between the particles within any single object itself. For you, the tree is something that exists by itself. When it has been cut down, it is so much lumber. The stump continues to exist as a thing by itself. And yet, from the point of view of mechanical science, the relationship between atoms and electrons in the stump of the tree with those in the star Sirius is just as real as the relations existing between the electrons in the trunk of the tree. The trunk is not an object there because of the physical definition that you give to it. Every field of force that surrounds every electron is related to every other field of force in the whole universe. We cut our objects out of this world. The mechanical world reduces to a mass of physical particles in ceaseless motion. So far as such a world can be said to have any process of its own, it is that which is represented in the term entropy. With the appearance of steam engines, people tried to work out the theory of them. And a Frenchman, Sadi Carnot, had the happy idea of thinking of the heat which was responsible for the formation of steam as flowing downhill through different degrees of temperature. When the steam was hot, its expansive power was great, and then, as it lost heat, it lost its power to expand. As it flowed down the hill of temperature, it lost its power. Of course, energy is not lost in the universe. It is just dispatched into surrounding objects. Thus, Carnot was able to work out a theory of steam engines which hinged upon this knowledge of energy flowing down a temperature hill. You put your piston rod into this stream, and it will work the engine. But when it is at the bottom of the hill, it can do no more work. The mill cannot be turned by water that has passed. Well, now this presented a picture of the whole universe as just a congeries of atoms in the sort of motion that was called heat. When you set any sort of motion going, you know that you use up energy by friction in some way or other, and that you produce heat. The whole universe seems to be running down toward a condition in which this motion will be evenly distributed through the entire universe. All manifestations of energy are due to the fact that they are on high levels, so to speak. But given time enough, in the course of millions of years, everything will get evened out and all the particles will be in a fairly quiescent condition, with a slight, even motion of a Brownian sort distributed throughout the whole universe. That is the conception of entropy. That is the goal of the universe, if it has one, in which there will be some kind of energy evenly distributed throughout. We can be very thankful that we do not exist at that time. Of course, we could not exist then in any meaningful sense. That mechanical conception which science presents has no future, or a very dark one at best. Not dark in the sense of catastrophes, for those are always exciting, but dark in the very monotony of the picture. The conception of entropy is anything but exciting. Such a universe would answer only to an infinite sense of ennui. The scientific conception, the mechanical conception, of the world did not seem to be one that gave any explanation to the form of things. As I have said, science does not justify us in taking a tree, a plant, an animal, or a house as separate objects by themselves. As we know, from the scientific standpoint, there is no difference between life and death, simply a shifting of energies. From the scientific standpoint, the forms of things have no real significance. Of course, if you start off with a certain thing, given a certain form, you can use scientific technique to analyze it. But your abstract mechanical science, that to which Newton gave form, does not account for any object, does not account for the acceptance of one object rather than another. It was Kant who took the first step toward a theory of the heavenly bodies. He was very devoted to the mechanical science of his period, but his imagination carried him a step farther, and he tried to conceive how the present form of the heavens might have arisen out of earlier forms. His statement was one that really got its scientific formulation in Laplace's conception of the solar system as a great nebula, intensely hot to begin with, and which gradually cooled down. Kant had to assume a whirling nebula which cooled down and resulted in a series of rings moving about the center as it condensed, gradually developing into a system of bodies of unspecific form. The velocity of the bodies on the outside of the system would keep them from moving in toward the center, and out of these rings the planets would arise. That is the suggestion which Laplace took from Kant and made into an explanation of the way in which the solar system arose. This was the first step toward a theory of the evolution of the heavens. But what I now want to present is something different from this picture which mechanical science gives of the universe. It is an attempt to state an object in a certain form and to show how that form might arise. When you think of it, that is the title of Darwin's book, The Origin of Species, species being nothing but the Latin word for form. What is the origin of these forms of things? Mechanical science does not offer any explanation of them. Anyway, from the point of view of mechanical science, the form has no meaning. All that this science says about a particular form is that in referring to a certain object, you are isolating a certain group of physical particles, taking them off by themselves. Really, they are related to all physical particles. But the universe that we know is more than particles. It is a world of forms. Now the question is, where do these forms come from? Certain of the principal forms, Kant said, come from the very structure of our own minds. The theology of the period said the forms of animals and plants go back to a creative fiat of God. He gave the earth its form and all the stellar bodies, their forms and their motions, as well as those of the plants and animals. And that, of course, was the point from which the descriptive sciences of the time, biology, botany, and zoology, started. They assumed species of plants and animals which had been created by God when He made the earth. What Darwin undertook to show was that some of these forms must conceivably have arisen through natural processes. But how could the forms as such have arisen? Mechanical science could not explain them, because, from the point of view of mechanical science, form does not exist. There are only two objects, one the world as a whole, and the other the ultimate physical particles out of which it is made. All the other so-called objects are objects that our perception cuts out. That is, we distinguish the chair from the table and ignore the relations between them, because we want to move them about, we want to sit on the one and write on the other. For our purposes, then, we distinguish them as separate objects. Actually, they attract each other as physical particles, parts of a single, all-inclusive electromagnetic field. The forms are not explained by the mechanical science of the period. The biological and other sciences, such as cosmology, astronomy, all explained certain forms which they found insofar as they did account for them, by saying that they were there to begin with. And even Kant assumes that the forms of the mind are there to begin with. Now the movement to which I am referring, under the term theory of evolution, is one which undertakes to explain how the forms of things may arise. Mechanical science cannot explain that. It can break up forms, analyze them into physical particles, but it cannot do more than that. Biological science and astronomical science both start with certain forms as given. For example, Laplace's conception is of rapidly revolving hot nebular bodies which were present to start with. Biological science started with certain living forms, geology, with definite types and forms of rocks. These sciences classify things in accordance with the forms that are found. But they do not generally undertake to show how the forms arise. There is, of course, the science of the growing form, embryology. But this is a recent science. It accounts for the way in which the adult arises out of the embryo. The older theory of biology assumed the form already there. It even conceived of a complete man as given in the very cells from which the form of the embryo developed. The assumption was that the form was there as a precondition of what one finds. This is Aristotelian science. It is also essentially Kantian. We have seen how we conceived of the forms of the mind as given, as the precondition of our experience. Now Lamarckian and Darwinian evolution undertook to show how, by a certain process, forms themselves might come into being, might arise. Starting with the relatively formless, how could one account for the appearance of forms? Lamarck started with the hypothesis that every activity of the form altered the form itself, and the form then handed on the change to the next generation. As a picturesque example, assume that the progenitors of the giraffe wanted or had to feed off the leaves of trees and so stretch their necks. They handed this stretched neck on to their longer-necked offspring. The inheritance of so-called acquired characteristics was Lamarck's suggestion to account for the appearance of forms. He assumed, as did Darwin, that you start with relatively formless protoplasm, and went on to show the process by means of which forms might arise from that which was relatively formless. We were discussing romantic idealism, and we pointed out that it was a development, or an expression of the spirit of evolution, of the definite entrance of the idea of evolution into Western thought. Indeed, we spoke of Hegel's philosophy as a philosophy of evolution. This highly abstruse speculative movement is simply a part of this general movement toward the discovery of the way in which the forms of things arise, of origins. As a scientific undertaking, it was not aided by the physical science of the time. It had to make its own way, and this it did to an amazing extent. In later generations, it became a guiding idea in practically all investigations. I mentioned earlier the distinction between the conception of evolution that belonged to the older ancient thought, which got its classical expression in the Aristotelian doctrine, and the evolutionary theory of this period. The Aristotelian evolution was the development of the so-called form, the nature of the thing which was already present. It presupposed the existence of the form as something that was there. In this conception, a metaphysical entity was thought of which existed in and directed the development of the form. The species, which is the Latin word for the Greek term form, was actually conceived of as a certain nature that supervised the development of the seed of the embryo into the normal adult form. Under the conception of Christian theology, this form was thought of as existing first in the mind of God, then as appearing in the plants and animals and various other objects that He created, and finally as arising in our minds as concepts. The form, however, was not thought of exactly in the Aristotelian sense as existing in advance, as being an entelechy, the nature of the object existing in advance of the actual animal or plant. The difference between that conception of evolution and the modern conception is given, as I have already pointed out, in the very title of Darwin's book, The Origin of Species, that is, The Origin of Forms. It is an evolution of the form, of the nature, and not an evolution of the particular animal or plant. What this theory is interested in is the evolution of the nature of the object, of the form, in a metaphysical sense. It is this which distinguishes the later theory of evolution from the former, namely that the actual character of the object, the form, or the nature itself, should arise instead of being given. As you may remember, Darwin got the suggestion for his hypothesis from Malthus' doctrine of population. This was an attempt to show the relationship which exists between population and the food supply, and what effect this relationship may have on the future of the race. Of course, Malthus' statement was greatly disturbed by the introduction of machine production. This upset many of his calculations, if not the theory as a whole. Yet, it is interesting as an attempt to state in definite ways what the experience of the race will be in the light of a single factor in its environment, that is, the food supply. Darwin became very much interested in this problem, and it led him to undertake to explain certain variations which take place in forms as being due to the pressure of population. In nature, there are always more forms born into the world, more plants and animals, than can possibly survive. There is a constant pressure which would lead to the selection of those variants which are better adapted to the conditions under which they must live. This process of the culling out of these better adapted forms would, in time, lead to the appearance of new forms. What lies back of this conception is the idea of a process, a life process, that may take now one and now another form. The thing of importance is that there is a distinction made between this life process and the form that it takes. This was not true of the earlier conception. In it, the life process was thought of as expressed in the form. The form had to be there in order that there might be life. The idea of which I have just spoken, I have referred to as Darwinian. The same idea lies back of the conception of Lamarck. He assumes a life process which may appear in one form or another, but which is the same process whatever form it takes on. The particular form which it does assume depends upon the conditions within which this life process is run. Thus we find the same fundamental life process in plants and in animals, in the amoeba, in man, and in every form between. It is a process that starts in the separation of carbon and oxygen. These two, in the form of carbon dioxide, exhaled by animals as a byproduct of the assimilation of food, are found in water solution in plants as carbonic acid. Through the mediation of the action of chlorophyll and light, this eventually becomes food, in the form of various sugars and starches. These starches are then carried to tissues that expend energy, that burn up and set free energy in the life of plant or animal, get rid of waste products, set up the means of reproduction, and so pass on from one plant or animal to another, from one generation to another. The essentials of that life process are the same in all living forms. We find it in unicellular forms, in multicellular forms. The only difference is that in the case of the latter, we find a differentiation of tissues to carry out various functions. We find different groups of cells that take up one of the phases of the life process and specialize in that. The lungs take in air, oxygen. Another group of cells becomes the means of the circulation of the blood. Others take over the functions of ingestion, of locomotion, of secreting fluids that make digestion and reproduction possible. In other words, separate groups of cells carry on different parts of the life process. The whole process, however, is the same as that which goes on in unicellular forms. That, you see, is involved in this conception of evolution, a life process that flows through different forms, taking on now this form, now that. The cell, as a single entity in the whole, remains fundamentally what it was in the unicellular form. All living cells bathe in some fluid medium. Those cells on the outside of us are dead. Living cells are those which are bathed in the fluids of the body, such as the blood or lymph. They are the only ones which are alive, and they carry over into the body some of the original sea from which our original unicellular existence migrated. These cells went from the surface to the bottom, and their multicellular forms arose. From the bottom of the sea to man, they had to bring this precious fluid in which alone cells can live. This was first found in plants. And animals then came and lived upon the plants, but the life process has flowed through all and remains the same life process. Given such a conception as this, it is possible to conceive of the form of the plant or the animal as arising in the existence of the life process itself. It is very important that we should get the conception of evolution that is involved in it and distinguish it from the earlier conception, especially if we are to understand the appearance of this conception in its philosophic form. We are concerned with a theory which involves a process as its fundamental fact, and then with this process as appearing in different forms. Now the Romantic idealists, who first developed a philosophy of evolution, came back, of course, to our experience of ourselves, that reflexive experience in which the individual realizes himself insofar as, in some sense, he sees himself and hears himself. He looks in the glass and sees himself, he speaks and hears himself. It is the sort of situation in which the individual is both subject and object. But in order to be both subject and object, he has to pass from one phase to another. The self involves a process that is going on, that takes on now one form and now another, a subject-object relationship which is dynamic, not static, a subject-object relationship which has a process behind it, one which can appear now in this phase, now in that. To get the feeling for this romantic idealism, one must be able to put himself in the position of the process as determining the form. And it is for this reason that I have said what I have in regard to evolution. That does not get us as deep into our experience as the subject-object relationship does. Logically, it is of the same character, namely a process in this case, a life process going on that takes now one form and now another. The process can be distinguished from the form, yet it takes place within the different forms. The same apparatus for digestion has to be there, the same apparatus for expiration, for circulation, and for the expenditure of energy have to be there for the life process to go on, and yet this life process may appear now with this particular apparatus and now with that. In your thought you can distinguish the process from the form. And yet you can see that there must be forms if the process is to take place. We have spoken of the unicellular animal as having no form in that sense. That statement is not entirely correct. We know that there is a high degree of organization of molecular structure in the cell itself. We can follow it out in a vague sort of way. You cannot have a process without some sort of a structure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.